The Swell Season podcast is recorded by the Newsstand Studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan and is distributed by the Swell Season Surf Radio Network.
I stood on Cape Cormo in the sun's evening glow, and tuned hill at Newland to watch the fishing fleets go, watch the sheath whales and keever as they spun around, and heard the men singing as they go underground. And no one will ever move me from this land.
Hello, and welcome to the Swell Season Surf Podcast. I'm your host, Tyler Brewer. Finisterre, which in Latin, finis terrae, means end of the earth, is a brand that exists first and foremost to meet the needs of the cold water surfer, both in and out of the water. People like to call them the UK version of Patagonia, but I'd wager founder Tom Kay must have mixed feelings about those comparisons. To be compared to an industry leader can be flattering, but I imagine Tom believes that they have their own unique voice and story to tell that can differentiate the two. Tom Kay, the driving force behind Finisterre, has been at the game for over 20 years, slowly building a great reputation for quality products that are sustainably minded. The brand has gained a cult following among surfers worldwide, who I suspect feel underrepresented in the larger surf culture. Tom and his team are currently poised to make big moves in the coming years that will help to drive the surf world to think more sustainably. I was fortunate enough to have met Tom late last year at an event at their beautiful store in London off High Street through my mate Matt Barr at the Looking Sideways podcast, which I highly recommend listeners check out. Tom was extremely friendly and engaging, and you can tell this was a very sharp but passionate person. Unfortunately, I had to leave shortly after the meeting Tom, but the few minutes I got to speak with him, I felt like I could talk to him all night. And so I decided I needed to have him on the show. And I'm super excited because we are fortunate enough to have Tom as a guest on this episode of the Swell Season Surf Podcast. Tom, hope I buttered you up nicely there.
That's a really, really good buttering up. Thank you. What a buttering up.
I bring you up and then I'm just going to cut you down.
That's how life is. Yeah.
So stoked to have you here. And I'm really excited because I think my listeners, particularly in that Northeast New York region,
yeah,
really, I think, can identify with your brand, and you've been a big supporter of some of the local surfers here. It's awesome, and I've been following Finisterre for years, and so it's super cool, like, thank to you. Get to meet you, and I'm really excited about all the stuff that you guys are working on. I wanted to start with, I think, like, both of us kind of grew up outside of the mainstream, like, image of surfing. Mm-hmm. You know, we grew up in kind of hardier, colder environments. And I was curious, like, when you were growing up and when you were getting into surfing, what was your image of surfing and the surf industry and, you know, growing up? And I was hoping you can contrast that with what you were experiencing as a surfer when you were younger.
Yeah, so thanks a lot for having us on. And, lots of the reciprocated buttering up back to you and all you do out over there. So great to be connected a few 6 months ago. And I guess if I think about my life and the life I lead, and I think when I was sort of my formative years, sort of 14, 15, 16, many, that's when you kind of discover your not your tribe, but what it is that you know you're going to, what you know your community belong to, whatever. And for me, it was surfing. I loved it in every single respect. It was different. It was physical. It was an understanding of the sea, which I've been lucky enough to have been, you know, in and around the sea my whole life. So, and it, you know, it really fulfilled me, and it became my kind of formative part of my life because it sort of defined everything I've done in my life since then. So, you know, but the sort of surfing I was doing was the surfing over here in the UK and Ireland, where it's, you know, the weather changes on a dime. It's, you know, it's windy, it's rainy, it's freezing cold. It's, you know, incredibly fickle, but on its day, it's some of the best, you know, surf anywhere in the world, you know. And yeah, for me, that's the kind of life I knew and understood, and probably like many of the listeners in the Northeast, is a similar kind of, you know, watching weather charts, really understanding swell patterns and low pressure systems and all that sort of thing, and knowing, you know, where to go when, you know. This is going back 25 plus years. You look at the, you know, the old guy on the weather report after the news, and you had like a snap decision to make where to go depending on where the low pressure was behind his back, and if it was going to be, you know, high pressure over the UK, so you get the favorable wind. So that was kind of life I knew, and I loved it. And it was, you know, and I think there's a romance to it. There's a bit of suffering in terms of, you know, having to go through the commitment of everything, and it wasn't perfect every day, but I felt the rewards and the experience and the camaraderie and all that sort of stuff that I got from it was something really, really connected with me, and I really understood. And I guess this was, you know, late 90s, early 2000s. You know, I suppose a lot of the brands that, in inverted commas, were, you know, in my world. And, you know, if you think back then, it was, you know, I can remember it was getting a surf mag that was out like once a month, if you're lucky, maybe twice every other month, to one news agent that, you know, nearby, that may or may not stock it because it wasn't mainstream. And that was pretty much your sole source of like intel. And, you know, now obviously Instagram and social media and watching WSL on, you know, live from your bed, whatever.
No, it's crazy.
While the pipe master's on or whatever. So it's, you know, it's a very different world. But that was, I think there was a lot more, you know, those kind of subcultures there were much more, the boundaries are much less defined than they are now. And so you were in that kind of subculture. But I guess what I'm saying, you open those magazines back then, the majority of the surf brands were, you know, bikinis and board shorts, flip flops, whatever. And here was I in, you know, north coast of Scotland, you know, there's frost on the ground. It's, you know, 5:30 in the morning. It's just getting light, and it's, but the waves are amazing. And, you know, that there was a disconnect between what I felt I needed from a product and a brand, and also not only in terms of the functionality of the product, also how it's made, what it's made of, and this more kind of responsible way of being as a business. And those are really the kind of kernels in terms of the idea and what went into starting Finisterre.
What did you like? A couple of things, I think. One is, I think we have in common that I think the expression "should have been here an hour ago" is probably common amongst both of us, you know? So I think it changes on the dime, like you said. And God, like, I was even thinking just how your tides there are so dramatic.
Yeah,
it changes.
Big tides, yeah.
Crazy. The, like, did you feel connected to the surf world? Like, I always felt like an outsider to surfing. And I always felt like, you know, that everything was coming, especially at that time, you know, it was controlled in Southern California. They had the megaphone, they had the magazines. In Europe, I imagine, yeah, maybe New Key had a little bit of that voice in parts of France. But really, I never felt fully connected to the industry, even though, like, that was the image we were pressed upon. And I'm like curious, like, did you feel that way as well? Did you feel like not connected at all and felt like these guys aren't really representing what surfing looks to me?
Yeah, I think, you know, you're connected in one respect because you're always, you know, admiring, you know, and, you know, taking inspiration from the actual surfers and what they're doing, you know, on the waves, you know. And there's been numerous kind of groundbreaking characters who have sort of shown a way. So there's always an interest in terms of the sporting boundaries being pushed, but the industry, yeah, was far removed from the searching or the miles away from where it was, and it was often in board shorts and warm water, and everyone loves a warm water trip. I get that, but the majority of what I was doing was very different to the industry and the kind of, I suppose, what was being fired at me in the magazines.
Where did your appreciation and sense of duty for like the environment come from? Was that something your parents showed you? Is that something you grew up like learning about? Was that like that sustainability aspect particularly?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think, I've been in and around the sea my whole life. My mum particular was super keen on nature and environment, but both my parents were as well. And then I did biologies and sort of science stuff at school, and did marine biology, biology and marine focus at university. And so I suppose that sort of environmental, coastal, marine, sea theme ran all the way through my life, including what I did at university. And then, so I was aware of it and I had a massive interest in it. And it sort of, I just always felt very at home in that environment, not only in terms of like being in the water, but also understanding as much as I could about it from a scientific point of view, I suppose. I guess there's always been awareness of that. And for me, with the brand Finisterre, it's always been a brand that's kind of punched its weight above its weight in terms of just a transaction, in terms of the brand being a platform for change or having conversations or activism, whatever you want to call it. And so that was clearly going to be a strand of the brand back in 2003 when he founded it, 21 years ago. So that's been there since the beginning. And I suppose there's a natural kind of understanding that I had of that world, and for me to bring that into the brand was just, that's what we just, what we should be doing and being that sort of business.
How did, like, where do you remember the moment when it was like, I'm going to start my own surf brand, or I'm going to start my own thing? Like, was it like a lightning bolt moment, or was this a gradual thing that happened?
It was probably like a gradual thing that happened, actually. And it was after I left uni. I worked in London for about a year and a half. And I can remember thinking, oh, wow, this can't be it sort of thing. After all this sort of like passion and, energy and that sort of stuff that I had. You get to the end of university days, like, right, here come, let's get on with life. And I was doing a very sort of not very.
What was your job?
It was what's called chart surveyor. So it's like looking at commercial property and making sure that offices haven't got like pigeons in a roof and stuff like that. Literally, it was that sort of thing. And then I can remember walking around going, how can I build something that represents my passions? And like a brand is a set of values, stand for something, has a point of view. And you can, fold into a brand the things that are important to you, which I did do, and they called it Finisterre. And even since day one, our first website was a commitment to product, to environment and people. And that's been there since the beginning. So it was, about really good sort of products, really, great culture, and also in terms of being better as a business from environmental, sustainability, responsibility point of view.
What were people's reactions when you're bouncing this idea off them, like your friends and family?
Yeah, they were like, I think your friends and family, like, they're sort of like, that's quite a left field change of tack. I suppose when you look at it back on it now, it wasn't, because, you always encourage your kids to follow their heart. So I guess, being a surveyor in London wasn't following my heart at all. So there's that kind of encouragement around, people following their heart and their belief and that conviction. But there's an economic sustainability kind of reality around, paying rent in a house or whatever, or, living. So there's also, I suppose, as a parent or friend, there's that worry. but generally people would go for it and supportive. And yeah, I think, you know, some people didn't, many people didn't get the environmental thing back then, because, you know, that's a long time ago now. I mean, you know, even the last 3 or 4 years, it's just table stakes in terms of what you need to be doing as a business. But back then it was people that element that they didn't understand so much. So we've done quite a lot of education and honest conversations with our community and with our customers and stuff to get that over.
I've read, like, you've talked about you weren't a businessman or a designer when you started, and I'm wondering, like, as someone who's interested in starting a business, like, what skills did you have or felt that you had that helped you succeed and persevere, and what did you have that you attribute to your success?
That's a great question. I think, you know, it's interesting, like, as I said, I wasn't a designer, I did marine biology university, I wasn't a businessman, and I think if I look back now, you know, that was evident in terms of, like, you know, understanding, like, what profit and loss is like, and what, you know, that sort of thing, and no idea. But I always believed, and it's like blind naivety or conviction, that there was room in the world for a brand like Finisterre, and, you know, that's been unwavering. When I started it and we had our team away day yesterday, and the spirit of that belief and that energy is even more evident in the business now as it was then. But that sort of conviction, so you have that belief, you know, where you're going. But also, I think probably the biggest trait I think you have to have is just resilience. And, you know, I'm always inspired by the resilience of the human spirit, and that exists all over the world. But for me, you know, on that journey to, you know, that conviction, that direction in terms of what we're going, what we're going to achieve as a brand, was this kind of resilience to be able to handle the highs and the lows and the ups and downs, which have been many, 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 many. So, yes, yeah, so I think conviction in terms of where you're going, and that isn't necessarily something you learn or in a business plan. And then the resilience to be able to see through the troughs on that journey that you're on.
What about, like, how did you go about learning about designing the clothing? How did you discover the sourcing of the material? Like, I imagine it must have been really difficult at that time, 2003, to find sustainable raw materials to make the product. Like, how did you go about that?
It was.
How did you go about that?
It was. I mean, I think, you know, I often get asked that question that, you know, do talks, universities, and then how do you do it? And if I look back on it, there wasn't any, like, magic formula. It was literally deciding that, you know, the product I wanted to make was this windproof, waterproof, breathable fleece, and you get out of the sea in the middle of February over here. It's what you put when you get changed in the car park. And so I got fabrics, I put stuff together, we sewed it up, we wet it, we dried it, we left it to, you know, air dry in the garden, we blew through it. And then I worked with a textile research department, Leeds University, to check the kind of, you know, the functionality of the product. They were amazing. And then we had, like, a really, you know, really well-made, like, bomb-proof product. And you still see it around today, 20 years later.
Wow.
And I'm glad to say the aesthetic has moved on. We've got an amazing design team now who, you know, evolved the aesthetic and, you know, the look of the product. But in terms of the kind of the ingredients of what a product should do, you know, fit for purpose, last a long time, be able to be fixed and repaired, you know, to be around 21 years later, I think it met the brief, really.
How are your threading skills?
Yeah, pretty good, actually. I quite like, I've done tons of repairs. I was doing, now my threading skills, I not include my own stuff, or they also include my kids' teddies. They're like, can you fix this for me? So get the head torch on and, like, get repaired.
See that on your LinkedIn profile.
No, I'm actually get it on there now. Yeah. So it's I mean, we have repairs. We've done repairs here for, like, 15 or plus years. We're at Wheel Kitty on the north coast of Cornwall right now, and the sea's, like, you know, 100 meters to 200 meters away. But we've done repairs here. We now have repairs in many of our stores, and so it is a big part of the ethos of the brand, I suppose, in terms of, I suppose it comes down to making you fall in love with your product.
Yeah.
And, you know, that you, if you have something, you really love it, you look after it, you look, fix it. And so I was trying, you know, and I'm always, when I go and do talks, you know, people are like, oh, well, you're not wearing, can you get the latest shirt on? It's like, this one's fine. It's like 5 years old. It's, I don't even need one. And so I guess, you know, I like have a product that has for a long time, that really wears in, and you love it, and you look after it, and you repair it when necessary. And, you know, and it just becomes something you really care about. So I'm always trying to bring that to life in the product.
Do you still go down to like knit now just to meditate almost? Like, do you find that actually to be meditative and relaxing, or is it escape?
Yeah, I mean, repairs, you know, I don't knit, but like doing repairs is, fixing stuff is, I get, yeah, is satisfactory, very satisfactory. And I, yeah, fixing, mending stuff is good. And it gives me satisfaction to know that, yeah, you fixed up like an old friend, a bit of jacket or fleece or whatever it is, or a wetsuit. And it's going to go on to be with you on, you know, the next part of the journey or adventure.
I was reading about how you started out like in your apartment yelling at your roommates to get off the phone because you needed the dial-up internet. And yeah. There was something about that to me that like just speaks to me. And I just love that. And I was hoping you can kind of describe that scene of the early days a bit. Like, what, and do you miss those early days, or do you look back on them fondly, or do you look at back and I'm like, oh, I'm so glad I'm past that almost?
Yeah, it's funny. It's like, so the early days, I'm calling you from St. Agnes, which is like a smallish sort of village, or, you know, medium-sized village right on the coast of north coast of Cornwall. It's like incredibly rugged.
St. Aggie crew in the house.
Yeah, Aggie crew in the house. And it's a great sport here, great people, and on its day, good waves. And then, so it was a flat above the surf shop, and it was literally getting 50 fleeces made at a time, a 3-page website, you know, getting back from the day job because I was doing other work at the time, you know, getting your housemates off the phone to get on the internet, as you said, get orders of download, and I just send stuff off. So you're doing everything. And it was like, my bed was at one end of the room and had like a stack of fleeces at the other end of the room, and that's how it went. And yeah, so do you miss those early days? I mean, I think it's, you know, you look back at those days, and I always regret I didn't take more pictures because we have camera phones around then. But
yeah,
you know, having photos of those early days when it's me, there's 3 or 4 people, and, you know, we've got furniture in the office donated by the postman's mum had died, whatever, you know, it's like, and it was proper, you know, it's proper, like, you know, early days startup hustle. And, you know, I guess you miss them in some respects because that sort of startup, you know, is really exciting because you're all connected by this like common bond of, you know, pretty much taking on the world, doing things better. That's incredibly like empowering. And but it's also, you know, you're running out of money. You're trying to put adverts in magazines against bigger brands that you haven't got budget for. You're going to trade shows to sell the product because it's only days e-com, and you're having to get on the floor and hustle and sell fleeces to people. So there's the proper hustle. But I think, you know, so they were great times. And I can remember always saying, remember, like anything in life, remember, you know, this time now, because it'll be different next year. And it won't necessarily be, you know, it's not different in a bad way. It would be different. So you've got to really remember the now and enjoy it. And, you know, nothing good or bad lasts forever.
I'm curious, like, did you envision when you started, were you like, and where you are now, is that vision still consistent? Like when you started and you had the vision of what the brand and the company would be like, and where you are now, do you feel like it's where you believed you would end up, or did it take turns to where you're like, oh my God, I never even thought it would be like this?
Yeah, the thing is, that's a super interesting point, because I think if I look back, I'm like, this is exactly the sort of brand I imagine it being. I'm really proud of everything we're doing. It's been, you know, it has been hard. You know, it's been 21 years.
Yeah.
And, you know, and behind all the beautiful brand stuff is you have to, you know, be financially sustainable so that you can do all the good stuff. And that's been, you know, with a growing clothing brand or, you know, outdoor clothing brand, there's it's the working capital cycle with regards to, you know, buying product and stock is pretty hectic. So there's that side of it people don't often realize. And so that's been hard over the years. But yeah, if I look at our latest impact report we've done and see all the areas the brand is, you know, changing and not judging, but saying that this is the way that we think we should do it, be it renting Ulex wetsuits, be it the Finisterre Foundation, you know, equal access to the ocean for all, whether it's a lived and loved repair, lots of different aspects of the brand, and they've been brought to life. And so, yeah, you imagine things like that happening. You don't necessarily know exactly what they're going to be. And I think if you have your true north set out as to, you know, purpose, what you're here to do as a brand, and that is unwavering, which it has been, then you can go off and do things in these areas as, you know, situations arise or as customer need comes to the forefront. And so, I think it is, you know, we've just taken our, you know, sponsored Surface Journal this year, and that's like, you know, that
it's huge.
Yeah, I've read that publication, you know, for as long as I can remember. And so for us to be in there and have a lovely relationship with them and them be really excited about us being in there and that sort of thing was a big moment. So yeah, there's things like that you hope will happen, and when they do happen, it's amazing. Yeah.
Did, when you were coming up with the core principle, like, well, here I want to ask, like, first, like, how did you come up with those core principles? What was the planning that went into that? And then my second part of my question is, like, how do you maintain those core principles after all these years? Because I'm sure it's happened where you've been tempted for a big sale or a big opportunity, but it might cost you or have you compromise some of your core values. And so I'm curious, like, first, like, how did you come up with your core values? What are they? And then how do you maintain that and not sell out?
Yeah, so I think that, you know, the core values were, I like the idea of, you know, the business or the brand being a set of things that you stand for and emotional, you know, an emotional kind of beliefs and point of view and that sort of thing. So there's always going to be more than just a product. So it was always, you had, you know, a really quality product at the heart of it that you needed. And I always believed that for brands to have longevity to it, it had to start with sort of a reason why it started and a need for product. And that's like exists today. But beyond that, it was like, we also want to have the people elements of it. So a place where you have a great culture, people can come and work, you know, feel like they're working for something bigger than themselves, as well as supporting their own needs. And then, you know, finally, like we've talked about a bit already, but having the brand have an impact beyond just being a business, as a platform for change, if that's content, storytelling, events, whatever it is, to hopefully show, you know, lead by example. So those three commitments have been there since day one, and they still exist today. There's been times, I suppose, when we've had difficult decisions to make. We have, you know, I did a talk a couple of days ago, and there's like, we did 21 years of, you know, pioneering sustainability, innovation, all things we've done around the brand that have come to life. But behind each one of those stories is like challenging, you know, situations. You know, when you've got, you know, going back 10 years and there was a recycled nylon or there was a nylon, you know, and the nylon lasts longer and the recycled one is new, so you don't know what it does. How do you, you know, address those decisions in terms of being, you know, what's right, you know, what's right, yeah, for the brand, for the business, for, you know, the environment. And also coupled with, you're still a small business, then you've got a lot of commercial pressures going on. You know, there's times we went into, you know, running gear and, you know, we thought we were good at fabrics, which we are, and we'll widen out the fabrics into other activities. And that was a big mistake because people kind of lost who we were as a brand and didn't totally understand us. So there's many, and there's been many sort of failings, I suppose, or learnings along the way. We've turned down in the early days investors that I didn't feel were on board with, you know, what we were doing as a brand. And that's hard because you know, as a startup, anyone will tell you, you just run up money the whole time. So it's like turning down, you know, some capital to, you know, give you some breathing space so you can sleep at night and pay your wages or rents or whatever it is, because you believe that they weren't aligned with what you're doing as a business and the way you're going to go as a brand. They were difficult decisions, but the ones that were the right ones.
Did you have a mentor or anyone that was helping you with this or helping guide you in any way?
Not really, no. I mean, I have, you know, I've got, you know, there's people who, you know, friends and people I've met along the way that have been, you know, really good, you know. And I guess what, for me, what fuels my tank is that, you know, one of the things I've heard consistently over my 21 years at Finisterre, and it's, you know, ultimately it's my life work, you know, I've done it since 27, is I love Finisterre because I love the brand, I love what you stand for, I love your product. And every time you hear that, that's a bit of fuel in the resilience tank for you to keep on that journey. So, and I got strength from that. I have a lot of people who've helped me out over the years and been supportive and talked to me, but there was not like one person, no.
I'm also curious, like, was Patagonia an influence for you? And were you looking to them as a model, all?
Yeah, I mean, I think, Patagonia, what an amazing brand, what an amazing example to us all. And I've got a lot of, you know, good friends that work there. What they're doing, achieving is amazing. So, yeah, it was definitely, you know, as a business model and a way of being a better business, I'd say that it's been more apparent what they've been doing in the last, you know, over their lifetime, the last like maybe 5 or 10 years. They were always a good brand to look up to and have an amazing amount of respect. They, in terms of like a business model and the way you can grow a business and do it in the right way, I think it's a great example.
Does it bother you or do you take it as a compliment when people compare Finisterre to Patagonia or when you hear they're the UK version of Patagonia or things of that nature, which have been referenced, you know, a few times.
I think I take it as a compliment. You know, I think it's a great thing for people to reference. And if it helps them understand the sort of business we are, then that's fantastic. I also think that, you know, there's things that we do differently to them, which means we stand on our own 2 feet and are different in many ways as well.
I'm also like then curious, like were there other influences, other companies that influenced you or you look towards as like a guide, you know?
I think that, you know, it's probably a bit cliche now, but I think, you know, some of the first adverts we ran were pretty disruptive in some surf magazines, and they were kind of based on some of the, you know, the early Apple ads, you know, when it was, you know, welcome to the category. And, and I often say, you know, we're as a brand, we were the first like 4 or 5 years, we were like, you know, just working out. Then we had this kind of we get into sort of the adolescent emo years. We poked a few bears and sort of things like that. So, you know, when you're kind of just working out who you are, I think. And then we kind of got nice sort of like, you know, pace in terms of who we are and confidence around the brand and stuff like that. So, but to answer your question, I think, you know, some of those, when we were trying to, you know, and this social media wasn't really around then. So you've got, you know, you're trying to get your name and your, be disruptive in what you do, I think we would kind of took some of those early Apple ads as good examples of, you know, disrupting industry. And then I think we're not so kind of explicitly vocal about it now, but we do it hopefully by example in terms of products or, you know, our stores or like content, that sort of thing. So that sort of spirit still exists, but I think it's less, it's got more clout to it and it's less kind of overt in terms of being in print magazines.
Were you, did you get a lot of pushback from the surf industry at all?
Yeah, we did actually. We did, like, you know, it was kind of, you know, initially it's like ignored. Then it's sort of like, you know, probably, you know, some of those adverts probably wound a few people up, but they got us attention and, you know, allowed us to sort of stand up for what we were doing. And then I think now we kind of, you know, we got respect from many people in the industry, and we are in the industry, and, you know, respectful of, you know, it's you know, respectful of them as well in terms of that sort of space. But it's, and, you know, it's not, I've never tried to be like judgmental as a brand. I think that's quite important. And, you know, we try to be brave as a brand, honest about that in terms of, you know, it's not easy. We're not perfect. We don't get everything right the whole time, but this is what we believe the right thing to do is. And that's how we do it. And hopefully that's an example of us just doing what you believe rather than it being sort of judgmental about what other people are or aren't doing.
How do you keep, or I'm sorry, how do you feel as you've grown now, like this sense, a greater sense of scrutiny on you? Because you do promote this environmentally friendly, sustainable company. And as you grow, I imagine there's more people, more armchair experts and people from the sidelines who just love to pick things apart. But I wonder, like, do you feel that scrutiny as you grow?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I guess I'd sort of describe it as there's froth. Mm-hmm. Like, i.e., people, you know, just kind of going crazy on social media, you know, on the way back from the pub or whatever, you know, yeah. There's that sort of stuff. And, you know, if people really looked at what we're doing, you know, and then there's like informed scrutiny where you have really intelligent conversations with customers, you know, asking this sort of question, or how can you grow and maintain your principles or that sort of thing. So, and, you know, we welcome that. I think those are really, you know, interesting points of view, and they're not like binary in terms of what's right or what is wrong, but mm-hmm. they're debates, the stuff that we should be having. As I said, like, honesty is a big thing for us, so having those honest conversations with people that actually would like to know about them and understand it, and we can learn as much from our customers as hopefully they can learn from us. We kind of welcome them, but it's like, it is an interesting reconciling, you know, growth and, you know, being a brand that's based on consumption and environmental degradation and the way the planet is, you know, that's an interesting, those are very, and that's been around, you know, it's been around for 21 years. It'll be around for the next 21 years. How do we go about mitigate that impact, being responsible as a business, moving towards a positive impact business? And we're kind of honest about saying we caused damage, we haven't got it right. But if we can, you know, I guess you have to sort of, you know, in life, whatever, pick a lane and decide what it is you're going to do. And this is kind of the manifestation of, I suppose, of my ideas. Now there's the boy from the business sort of taking those and bring that to life, and hopefully being an example of a better way of being as a business. Or, and even if you don't buy anything from us, you know, I always get excited when, you know, we do things beyond the transaction, and we, you know, inspire people, or, you know, drive change or whatever it is, or show what can be done. So those are things that I always get excited about. So there's always been an element of the brand beyond just the product.
Like, the thing I imagine you must have lots of conversations about with your team is, like, how you keep that coreness while still growing and appealing to a wider audience.
Yeah.
And, like, how do you avoid the plague of, like, like finance bros wearing Patagonia sweater vests, you know, like, yeah. And getting that kind of image or that ick to it, you know? Like, I imagine you guys must have a lot of those conversations.
Yeah, we do. I think, you know, we're obviously, you know, growing and still quite, you know, we're not young, but we're still, you know, we're sort of not of a, I wouldn't say a significant size of the business, but, you know, it's, so it's, I guess it's, I think from me, my point of view, being a founder, and if I can, you know, rest knowing that what we're doing is honest and with integrity and authentic to who we are as a brand, and we've got our feet on the ground and have this kind of honest dialogue around we're on a journey and we're never going to get there, but it's like an ongoing evolution. Mm-hmm. And it's very much like, you know, the energy in here is sort of like that startup energy that I had 21 years ago. And but it's like exhausting and exciting at the same time because, but, you know, that's the way it is. So I was just really proud of that, the fact that that still exists in the business and, you know, driving change, making decisions. And, you know, for me, it's really exciting now. Like people, like the renting wetsuits idea was an idea I had. Someone talking in the water about not being able to afford a Ulex wetsuit. And I said, well, let's rent them. And we rented £4 a day.
That's
the world first that we've done that. And when then the team, super talented, passionate, you know, young team here took it on and made it happen in about 2 or 3 months. So I guess as long as we're doing stuff like that, and we are using the brand as an example, and we are true to who we are, then that I'm okay with that.
I want to talk about that, the wetsuit. Yeah. Like you're doing these rentals, and are you planning on like a subscription-based wetsuit at some point, or are there other models that can be explored?
Yeah,
I mean, business models with that?
I mean, I think it was all, you know, it's just, you know, the wetsuit industry has had quite, you know, lack of circularity in it for quite a long time. So, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, we made and it came back to me, and we worked with Ulex, which is great, and that's obviously being pioneered by Patagonia, and like, you know, we're real allies in that respect in terms of, you know, making the product better from a less harmful, way less harmful source. So, you know, it's great in that respect. But, you know, it came back to me, it's like, well, there's still like a pile of wetsuits at the end of like a 2 or 3 year season, and everyone's got loads in their shed, and they always there with your kids' wetsuits, whatever it is, or your mates don't come down as much as you thought they were. So you know, that wetsuit you were saving for your friend to surf, he's got married and he doesn't come down anymore, whatever. And so, you know, it gets its own life. So I think and that became evident. So we made a wet, you know, and so suddenly it's like, well, it's all going to landfill. So we made a full-time wetsuit recycling available. So I think to answer your questions, in terms of like, you know, take the circular business model, you start with a better alternative Ulex, you then help them fix it, repair it, then what happens at the end of its life solution? And the wetsuit industry has been hugely lacking in terms of that end of life solution. It's not even on anyone's radar. It is now a bit, and you know, we've been trying to work it out and crack it. It's incredibly complicated. But I was thinking, if you know, all the stuff they could do in the world, we must be able to make wetsuits from wetsuits. So how can we do that? So yeah, the idea, the ultimate would be like, you know, you don't own the wetsuit, you rent it, and you it's a service, you know, use wetsuits as a service, and you know, that's kind of and then it comes back, you recycle it, and it goes back into, you know, and have that proper circular model. So but that's something we committed to, like, you know, 5 years ago. And I think the brand, you asked about the brand having, you know, staying true to it was, you know, we're doing things like that don't really have a commercial, like, you know, gain on the cards at all. You know, it's like, we're going to work out how to recycle wetsuits. We have no idea where it's going to go, but we believe it's the right thing to do. So we'll get on and do that and talk about it and hopefully start some conversations in the industry.
I feel like that, like, model of, like, subscription-based owning of product is probably one of the more responsible ways to move, I think, within the industry. I kind of like the idea of like, okay, I'm going to pay a nominal fee monthly for the use of this wetsuit, and as it degrades, I can just trade it in and I keep that subscription. And so as a business, you're getting that constant stream of revenue and that loyal customer.
Yeah.
You know, and I wonder how far that can go sometimes, and what sort of product even we can expand that to.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's super interesting, and especially with, you know, younger demographic and stuff, that's kind of, that's, they're much more like, it seems much more natural to them to be the way that they should be, you know, engaging with brands and product use and stuff like that. Yeah.
I really want to ask this, and I've read like how you've had to deal with this a little bit, is like maintaining your passion for surfing and other activities while it's tied to your company's image. And that's something I've always struggled with, was the idea of my passion in being my work, you know, like the thing that is my escape is also now my stress.
Yep. Well, I think it's like, I was thinking about that the other day, actually. And the alternative is it isn't like that. And so you could be like doing some job that isn't connected to your passion, and you do get that clear boundary, but you're probably always wanting to be, you know, you're always, if you're working or whatever, like in a, you know, a job somewhere that isn't related to surfing at all, you're always thinking about surfing. So I guess the way I'm made up is that I would rather, and lucky to be doing what I'm doing and having that, that constant, you know, and also like, you know, hanging out with people that like, you know, love what I love. It's the ocean, it's the sea, not, you know, swimming, surfing, whatever it is, there's that passion. And that's kind of, you know, you get energy and strength off that. You know, there's obviously downsides when you get in the sea and just trying to get away from stuff and people coming about, talk to you about work all the time. But I suppose that, and as you said, it becomes, you know, you, like you said, you find, you know, your work, your passion becomes the thing that stresses you out a bit.
I read how you like to avoid crowds as much as possible, and you will go surf a crappier wave to, you know, in order to escape a crowd. And I sometimes wonder if part of that calculus is not being in the water and someone paddling up to you and be like, hey, this suit actually has a little leak right here in the crotch or something, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's always like, if I'm in the water, I'll always chat to people in our suits, and it's good to hear how they're getting on. And I'm generally interested to, you know, because that is what makes us better. But yeah, sometimes I'll just go in on a, you know, junky day on a, like, one of my kids' foamy boards, just to kind of, and, you know, the thing, you know, I guess that relationship with the sea has probably changed over my life. You know, I think when you're younger, it was probably much more adrenaline fueled and sort of like, you know, you know, in inverted commas, getting the hit sort of thing. And it was like, whoa, you know, it's like, you know, it was more, not that I was a radical surfer, but my kind of, it was wanting to, but now it's more, yeah, a bit more soulful, a bit more, you know, I think with the brand and stuff, connected people to see is something we try and do a lot. And, you know, understanding that, you know, what it gives you and what you can then give it in terms of protection or activism when you're back on land is more how my relationship is. And also now with my kids, like passing that love on to them is, I get, you know, more pleasure from that than, you know, I will do that at the weekend rather than spend like 3 hours driving around trying to find a cleanish wave, 3-foot, 4-foot cleanish wave, rather just go and just like jump in the sea with the kids, you know, just mess around.
Well, in a few years' time when they're teenagers, you'll be driving around 3 hours looking for the right spot too,
yeah,
you know?
Exactly, yeah.
You know? Yeah. That's gonna happen. Yeah, you'll end up having, they'll be like, Dad, can we check here instead? Yeah. You know?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So yeah, that's kind of, I suppose, you know, that's the relationship with yeah, it sort of matures a bit, like, I found. Yeah, I still love going out on a big day, getting, you know, getting excitement from, you know, surfing a good wave, but it's sort of, it's less of a, you know, yeah, it's less, there's more of a, I suppose soulful might be a bit cheesy, but there is more of a sort of maturation in my relationship with the sea.
Can you talk about where you're located, the town of St. Agnes, actually, like how you came about there and what type of community it is? Because I've been to St. Aggie. I've had a couple good surfs. I've had a few friends from there. And everyone I've talked to has spoken so fondly of that community. And it seems to really stick out as like a counterbalance to Newquay almost, I feel like. And for our listeners who aren't from the UK, and this all sounds like gibberish or whatever, like, you know, Newquay is like Huntington Beach for the United Kingdom. And St. Aggie's, I think, is more got a Byron Bay-ish kind of vibe to it sometimes, maybe.
Yeah. So we're like in the, yeah, we're in the southwest of the UK, the far tip of the southwest, is sort of the bottom left-hand corner. And there's a huge coastline here. You get waves all over the place. And, you know, it's historically been the place, I think, you know, lifeguards turned up here in the 60s in Newquay from Australia, you know, introducing shortboarding and surfing. Although there was quite like an evident, there was sort of, there's always been a sort of surf culture here before that. Yeah. But that's kind of when sort of things really took off.
King Charles was a surfer.
Yeah, he was. Yeah. And it goes way back. Yeah. Edward as well, I think, surfboards from Hawaiians and stuff like that. So there's been, you know, because of the nature of the coastline, there's been this kind of, you know, awareness of surf and surf culture. We've got our own British surf culture. But I think it really kicked on. Newquay was sort of place where is the sort of, you know, the traditional surf center of the UK, where they used to have the, you know, the five-star Fosters events there. Yeah. And it is the sort of, you know, it's a big westerly facing beach, picks up a lot of swell, and great waves. That's the sort of the surfing, you know, it's busy, you know, quite big surfing town. And then we're like snagged just about like 25 minutes along the coast and that. It's an old fishing mining village. And when you get in this part of Cornwall, there's a lot of fishing mining kind of heritage, because they're the biggest industries historically. And this part of Cornwall, like, you know, in the 18th century, was the mining capital of the world pretty much, because there was tin mines, lead mines, copper mines. And, you know, Wheel Kitty, where we're calling from, means wheel, means place of work. And there's an old engine house just right next to us here, where there's a mine shaft, and then you go right down and right out to sea. So it's got a lot of sort of like heritage in it. And yeah, there's some really great waves around here. Really great people. There's some great, you know, you've got cord surfboards across the road. You've got surf skin sewage here. You've got otter surfboards. You've got, you know, there's a really good, kind of creative sort of culture and community, and just, you know, great bunch of people down here. So it's it's a good place to be.
A couple of great surfers have come out of there too. I remember meeting this guy Robin, who is this incredible regular foot goot and just knew how to backhand barrel, and a couple friends.
Robin Kent, was that?
Yes, yeah, yeah.
I know, he's a good friend of mine. He's good.
God, what a legend!
Power rider, and he, you know, in the early days, him and another good friend of mine, Mickey Smith, they'd be going off to
Ireland.
And then you're going to go down the coast where we are, and he gets a sort of Gwydion and a Hale, and then he goes beyond there, and it's like, it's Penwith, and it's like, it kind of gets even more, you know, quieter and remote and beautiful. And Mickey and his crew sort of discovered Eileen's over in Ireland with the Irish over there, and you know, hearing those stories is something that always excited me, when you're thinking of, you know people, you know, finding waves like that, you know, waves of
so close to home
or beauty that were, you know, there's there, and nobody knew about them. And I was that kind of pioneering camaraderie adventure, you know, is and I was never surfing those waves, but I know a lot of people, we've got loads of good friends live out there, and have surfed those waves and have pioneered them, and they give me good energy, those stories. Yeah,
I imagine you go through a lot of phases with your business. Yeah. You know, and like, you know, different parts interest you and you know, get your interest for a certain period of time, and I'm curious, like, what is currently taking up your headspace with work and like kind of your focus at the moment?
Yeah, it's a really good, I mean, I think, when you sort of like, when you start out, you're doing everything, you're packing the fleeces up, sending them out, phoning like journalists, like, you know, you're doing everything, and then it kind of...
Doing podcasts, you know.
Yeah. So now it's like, you know, 21 years, I do, it's kind of, it is my life's work, so I'm creating, I love it, and... there's as much going on now as there was, you know, back then. I'm involved in the product quite a lot, which I love, you know, making the right products and, you know, getting the right for our customers. I do quite a lot of creative in terms of the branding and the content and the storytelling, you know, making sure it's emotive and like connecting. And yeah, I'm, you know, I've done quite a lot of stuff around the impacts and the foundation. We couldn't finish their foundation, which was the sort of charitable part of the business, mm-hmm. which is set by my wife, which is really cool. And it's basically, that's kind of, I suppose that's something, you know, where the, that's funded by the business, and we do a lot of work, the adaptive wetsuits. I did a talk at a surf therapy conference. So I do quite a lot of talks, I suppose, as well. And it became clear that, you know, getting into wetsuit is one of the biggest barriers of getting into sea. Something yeah. you and I do without even thinking about it, probably. But it's like, oh, what? So people just don't go and see because they can't get into wetsuit. It's like, yeah, they are intimidated by it. They're not wearing it. They've got sensory issues, or, you know, maybe, you know, something physical in terms of they can't get the suit on. And so we then ran a wetsuit project where we basically, people could send their wetsuits in, not even our own wetsuit, any brand, and we would adapt that wetsuit for you. Nice. We raised money. We didn't run Black Friday, called it Blue Friday. We donated money from Blue Friday to the foundation and adapted a wetsuit. So we had these people writing in saying, my daughter is, you know, has cerebral palsy or whatever and can't get in the water, or can't get into a wetsuit with the rest of the family. Please, can you put a zip here or a zip there? And it's like, I read it out, and it's the, you know, it's, you know, so for me, the brand doing stuff like that is huge. Yeah,
it's interesting. Like, I have a friend who does wetsuit repair for Patagonia and other yeah. companies, and he does a lot of that work as well. Yeah. And I find like that is such a unique and creative area to work within, because you have to really refigure how to do things on a wetsuit, something that's conventionally done this way. Like yeah. it's all, you know, everything now is, you know, front zip, you know, yeah. and you just slip in, and everything is kind of similar. And for them, you have to really, it's a really great creative problem solving topic, you know. Like, you can really, I imagine, must be kind of really fun to kind of think about how we can make this work, and really gratifying.
Yeah, I think it's you know, we basically, so we will, you know, meet the person, you know, or they'll tell us what they need doing. And then what is gratifying is when you get that, those photos back or a letter back or whatever, and said, like, you know, the first time we went in the water as a family, and it was just, you know, it's just like stuff like that. And I guess, like, you know, realizing, you know, how lucky I am, and I have no barriers of getting into sea at all. And, you know, using that, you know, privilege, mm-hmm. which it is, and, you know, people say, you know, the you know, the worst you can do with privilege is waste it, and use that in a way that, through the brand and the business, that can hopefully, you know, help people out. And it's, yes, yeah, so it is really gratifying, and it's something, I suppose, that, you know, I'm getting more involved with at this stage of my involvement with Finisterre.
I imagine you're working with Nick at the Wave a little bit too.
Yeah, we do stuff with him, and there's an adaptive hub we have there, where we, you know, and the great thing about, you know, I know Nick really well, and, you know, the ability for that to be near like a massive urban centre like Bristol, one of the most multicultural cities in the UK, and have, you know, the ability for people to experience water and surfing there that might not be able to is huge. The social kind of impact is a good one. So yeah, we work with those guys really well.
I've noticed as of late, and speaking about barriers and access to ocean, you've really made an emphasis in your advertising and the models and that you include. It's become very inclusive and diverse in your marketing. Yeah. Like, you support a few BIPOC New York surfers, Farmada, Quest, and Paul, who are just the greatest people, and just, I absolutely adore them. And yeah. they are like, they're the future of New York surfing here, at least, and future of surfing, I think.
Yeah.
But I love how you've done that. And I want to know, one, was that a very conscious thing for you in the marketing to be more inclusive, and how you went about that and doing it in a, a real respectful way, as opposed to a you know, kind of, you know, I want to say like kind of talking down, like some other brands have kind of done a little bit more, like kind of just use them and not support them.
Yeah, so I mean, that's like, that's, I think, you know, we'd always, you know, try to be a great brand, but, you know, we're super friendly, super open, and, you know, hopefully inclusive. And we've always done that. But I think, you know, I think in the last, like, probably 3 or 4 years, we've sort of, we've lent into that even more. But it wasn't just doing something when everyone else started doing it. Mm-hmm. And because it was done with like meaning and integrity and honesty, and you know, like, and also the relationships that, you know, we generally build as a brand are ones that, you know, exist for a long time. It's not just like, I need you now, see you later sort of thing. It's like, I think that's kind of really come across in the content and the photo shoots and the film we make, as well as the product we make, being inclusive as well, from like a size point of view. So I think it's something that, we've done with integrity, we've done with honesty, and we're super grateful, you know, I guess that those elements in a brand have existed from the start, and it's great that people pick up on that and feel that, I guess they can trust us that we're doing it with the right intentions.
It's interesting. It's like, I feel like part of the reason why a lot of the surf industry, particularly in the US, is kind of in poor shape is because they didn't embrace that, you know, diversity and trying to expand surfing space to different demographics. Like, it became so insular and really, you know, and it's important. I think I've said this before on the show, like, I'm a firm believer in seeing it to believe it. And I think you need to see sometimes representation to believe you can do it as well. And I think like what you're doing is great, you know, and I wish more of the brands caught on to that, because that to me is the future of surfing. That's where surfing's going to get new life and new blood into the culture, instead of it being stale. And, you know, like all the legacy surf brands seem to just repeat their lines. Like, it's like, oh, we're doing 2000 retro line again, or we're doing this line again, and all, there's nothing new coming out.
No, I think these are the few elements that I think, you know, it's you know, there were, you know, 20 years ago there was a lifestyle, you know, that was sold on the back of surfing, which is why many even non-surf brands used it to sell their product, you know, from cars to, you know, clothes, not even surf clothes brands. So I think it's sort of, you know, they're and it has sold that lifestyle, which we've all been, you know, involved in, and, you know, probably looked up to at time, not looked up to, but, you know, sort of thought, that's sort of, but I think it's amazing there's been this course correction. It is astounding that some brands still haven't got onto that. Which I find really surprising. And then the problem is now that if you make that switch, it looks disingenuous.
Yeah.
And I guess the product thing is interesting as well, because I've talked about this before, like a while ago, but, you know, if you're having like organic cotton t-shirts, or a bit of your wetsuit line is, you know, bio rubber, you're not really replacing what you're doing. You're just adding on more. And you could even say that might even be worse. And rather than, you know, replacing what you were making, you know, you're not replacing what you were making with a better alternative. You're just adding it on. So, yeah, I mean, I'm not one to point fingers. We're just trying to lead by example and do the right thing. But I think, you know, I think it's, I mean, it's, you know, I mean, even in the last 6 months, there's been things where you're like, are you serious that's still how you're putting an advert out, and this is still going on? It's like, it just astounds me. And I guess, you know, I think going back to the foundations of the brand, the kind of being, you know, seeing what was lacking from a product point of view to start with, and then a brand point of view, it was always, you know, we've always tried to lead and sort of forge your own path.
So now you are in the process. I hope you don't mind me bringing this up, but you're in the process of launching in the US.
Yeah.
Correct. And
yep.
What do you, first I want to ask, like, what do you think are the differences between the US market and the UK market, and how do you plan on positioning yourself to stand out?
That's a really good question. I think it's so we're working with Chris Evans, who's our general manager in the US, and he for a while now, well, like, this is the start of the year. And firstly, what's been I suppose amazing for me is the kind of the earned sort of demand or knowledge, I suppose, of the brand that pre-exists, Chris turning up, which is, you know, that's for me, you know, we're here, I've been working here 21 years, like, you know, hustling away at the brand and what doing the right thing and what sort of things. So, and making this really great product. So for us to, you know, for people to go, oh yeah, I've known Finisterre for 5-6 years, I love what they do, and just really excited about coming to the US, which is, these conversations have been happening quite regularly. That's an amazing thing, and you know that means a lot, you know, for many ways to me. And so I think the brand positioning is as you see it, you know, in terms of we're not changing who we are. There's obviously, you know, there's ways of talking to a US customer that are probably a bit different. There's ways of you know,
you need more plus sized, you know, more, you know, double XL size and triple X for us, you know.
Yeah, you probably need to go, so triple XL. But I think it's, you know, so, and, you know, I guess we were kind of going at it quite nervously, you know, in terms of trying to answer these questions. And it's sort of where we stand today, it's turned out that, you know, the feedback has been the sizing is good. The product quality is good. The price point is spot on, and the brand we understand and believe in the brand. So, that's great, because the idea of having sort of like, you know, reinvent yourself or be something you're not for a different market was for me as a founder was always quite scary, I suppose. So, being able to be true who we are and talk to a US customer is, as we are, is really exciting.
Do you feel, now this is something I talk to a lot of my friends about who own businesses, and it's like, you know, the question of, like, you know, wholesale and direct to consumer.
Yeah.
And, you know, do you want to be more direct to consumer, have your own more retail shops located, or do you like to have the wholesale? Obviously you're gonna do both, but I sometimes wonder, like, in terms of control of where your product's being sold and how it's being presented must be a bit of a factor that comes into it. And how do you train people on the wholesale side who are selling your products that don't work for you? And then how do you control it on your B2C side, direct to customer, basically?
Yeah, so I think in terms of the UK now, we have 11 stores around the UK. We are, you know, three quarters D2C. And because when we started out, that's how, you know, it's like a three-page website. It was me selling products out. It was going to shows. We've always just had this relationship with our customers. And because I guess I was quite precious about the brand being in, you know, these big malls or whatever places, and you're losing, because, you know, I put my life and sweat and tears and everything into Finisterre. There's now an amazing team that are doing the same. So the idea of it not coming across in a big, you know, getting lost on a rail of product without knowing everything's gone into it, I was quite kind of precious of that. But I think, and so that's, but we are putting some wholesale up in the UK now. So there was a control element of that thing. But with the US, I think, you know, Chris, we're working with Proof Lab in San Francisco. That's been an amazing relationship that started and is going really well. Where they, you know, I think for them to understand the brand and what it is we're trying to do, and for them to know that there's a connect with their customers, I think it makes total sense. Similarly, Main Surfers Union in Portland.
Yeah,
there's,
yeah,
it's kind of, it's, you know, I think so. But there's, and I haven't been over there yet because I had some stuff going on with my family, but I'm going to go over as soon as I can to, you know, meet these people and understand and, you know, thank them for, you know, jumping on board and, you know, from a wholesale point of view. So for us, from a reach point of view in the US and being able to connect quickly with like-minded retailers and people who understand brands and that sort of thing is something I'm really excited about.
One of the things I feel like the surf industry kind of dropped the ball on and used to do really well to communicate their brand was sponsoring a lot of local surfers in different areas and people who belong to the surf shop that they, you know, sold to. And those things, when you have someone local who kids grew up, you know, looking up to, or other people, like, I feel like that's actually stronger in some ways than seeing someone on Instagram doing a big maneuver, you know, like it's like having someone in that lineup using the product and telling you direct to your face that they like that product and why they like it has more of an impact, I think, than like the clips that you get on social media.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, it's probably a blend of both of those things. And we've always, you know, supported, you know, people that have an aligned view. And that includes how you are in the water as much as it does when you're out of the water. And I think that's always been big for me, where, you know, surfing is the kind of the common ground, or if you like, that holds holds people you work with together. But equally, it's important, you know, what are you doing when you're not surfing? That's kind of always, I always find that really, that's something I'm always talking to the team here about. And so that, you know, what are you standing up for? Are you involved in this? Are you involved in that? Are you doing, you know, surf therapy, whatever, stuff like that, where there's a wider remit beyond just me surfing a wave in this way or that way. It's like, it's always more than that. So, and yeah, we're working with people over here like that, have been for a long time, and we'll always do that. And it's what we're looking to, we're starting to do over in the US as well.
So I'm going to have taken up so much of your time, and I really appreciate it.
No problem.
I want to ask then finally, like, how would you like to see the surf industry and overall clothing industry change and grow over the next 10, 15 years? You know, what do you see happening? Is circular economy possible? Like, what would be your dream scenario of where your business can go and other businesses can go to be the sustainable brands that you are, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, with the word sustainability is sort of, for me, it's lost sustaining is like maintain the status quo, which by argument, by default, you'd say isn't good enough. You know, it's like, you know, it has to be progressive, regenerative, or positive impact, whatever. So I think there's like, I guess there's like, you know, like all these things, there's, you know, there's pioneers and there's brands, you know, hopefully like us that can go off and, you know, whatever size we are, drive change, you know, lead by example, be honest about that, because it's going to be hard and you won't get it right all the time. And that, I guess that's what we do. And so if there's that circularity, if that's product passports or transparency or better sourcing or repairs or better fabrics or materials, that's kind of, that's a good thing. I mean, you know, if we became fully circular as a brand, you know, that have a little impact on, you know, say the CO2 emissions of the fashion industry. But if we could do that and, you know, show what can be done by example to other people in the industry, then that's hopefully, that's a good thing. So it's more of a like collaborative approach to, you know, to being in business. You know, we're B Corp certified, so that's obviously, that removes quite a lot of barriers of kind of competition from a business point of view, because you're generally aligned in terms of what sort of business you are and how you're going to do it, drive change and grow in the right way and that sort of thing. So I guess, you know, that kind of ongoing collaboration around brands to do better for the kind of the greater need of the planet or the ocean is something that I'd hope we would, you know, we would become more and more common.
When's the Tom K book coming out?
You could call it
I Let My People Go Surfing.
I need someone's asked me that the other day actually. I don't know. Maybe one day soon. Yeah, maybe one day soon. We've still got lots going on here, so I haven't quite got there yet. Yeah.
And when can we expect you coming through New York so we can take you for a surf here?
Yeah, soon actually. Maybe in the next few months. Actually, I'm just working out like family situation and all that sort of thing. But I'd love that. Thank you. Yeah.
Do we need to put together like a food tour for you as well? Like list of places, pizza places, and all.
Yeah,
that.
I'd love to see that through your eyes and meet all your community out there. I love that. Thank you.
Well, Tom, this was a great conversation. I really appreciate your time, your frankness, and just. Yeah, everything. Like, I'm so stoked on what you guys are doing. I love the brand, and I love the product. It's amazing. It's a really great fit and makes me look really good when I wear it. So I love it. And yeah, it's awesome, man. And I'm just super stoked. And I really appreciate all the work that you and your whole team have been doing. Like, they're doing a wonderful, wonderful job and doing it right. And it's awesome to see.
That means a lot, and always hearing that kind of feedback from all corners, it makes it worthwhile. So yeah, and so same back to you, and thanks a lot for having us on.
Cheers, Tom. Thank you.
For this is my Eden, and I'm not alone. For this is my Cornwall. I've left childish footsteps in the soft sand and sand. I've chased the man.